Hi, I'm Dr. Jeffrey Matthews. I'm here at Montclair State University in the Exercise Science Lab to show you how to take a blood sample and either turn it into a serum or plasma sample that can be either used or stored. So anytime you're handling a blood sample or other similar biohazard, make sure that you're wearing the appropriate clothes. So when you are working with a biohazard like blood, you need to make sure that you are protecting yourself from that biohazard. So you need to be wearing shoes that are closed so that there is no exposure of your feet. You need to be wearing pants that prevent any exposure of your legs. You should be wearing some sort of lab coat that protects most of the rest of your body. Then you need to be wearing gloves that protect you from anything that's going to get spilled on your hands. And you need to be wearing some sort of protective eyewear that's going to have some side shields as well as a lot of coverage to your eyes to prevent any splashes from getting to your eyes. So the type of blood samples we're talking about today are going to be collected either through a typical venipuncture just using a needle or an IV catheter, which is also a type of venipuncture. Either way, we're going to be collecting tubes that are typically going to be either a purple top or a red top. The purple top are the EDTA tubes that are going to prevent the blood from coagulating. The red tops are going to be the silicone-coated tubes that are going to promote coagulation of that blood. So whether you prevent coagulation or promote coagulation is going to determine whether you get plasma or serum. All right, plasma is what you get from the purple top tubes where you prevented the coagulation, so it still has platelets in it. Serum is what you're going to get from the red top tubes where you promoted coagulation. So essentially that coagulation is the clotting of those platelets. And so when you spin this down, you're going to end up getting just liquid and no platelets inside that liquid. So either way, you're going to take the blood tube when you first get it, and you're going to invert it very gently and very slowly, typically between 4 and 6 times. And that's going to make sure that the blood has been thoroughly mixed with whatever type of treatment is inside that tube. Again, either a coagulant or an anticoagulant. And then you're going to take the blood and you're going to set it upright in a tube holder and allow the blood to clot if it is a coagulating tube, or you can spin it right away if it's a non-coagulating tube. All right, so one mistake I made that you're going to see in this video is that I forgot to put them in a tube holder. It doesn't really make a big difference, but it makes it hard to tell whether or not the blood has been coagulated, because how you tell if blood has been coagulated is you take it and you very gently turn it upside down, and if the blood doesn't move, if it doesn't flow downward, then that means it's coagulated. And you can still see that with it being on its side, it's just not quite as clear. All right, so once you have confirmed that your coagulated blood or the blood that you want to coagulate has coagulated, then you can take the blood samples and you can put them in a centrifuge. All right, centrifuges can be set to several different parameters. You can set the temperature of the centrifuge, so you can make it room temperature, which is approximately what I'm going to be setting it at, or you can make it cold, which oftentimes needs to be done if you're running a sample for hormones or something that's going to degrade quickly at room temperature. The other things you can set are how fast it's going to spin. I'm going to spin it just beyond 3,000 RPMs. Or you can set also the time of the spin, which is something that typically is between 10 and 15 minutes. And you can decide whether or not to have a brake applied or how heavily to apply that brake at the end of the centrifuge time period. Set the those parameters to whatever type of analysis you're going to be doing, and then you're going to put the blood tubes inside the centrifuge. Now make sure that you're putting it inside the proper tubes within the centrifuge. So if you put it in tube holders that are too large for the tubes, it's not going to hold it very well, and you don't want that. So put it in the right size tube holders for the tube you're using. All right, so the other thing you need to do when you're putting the tubes inside the centrifuge is try to disperse them in such a way, or to place them in there in such a way that they are balancing each other in their weights. So if you have one over here, have one over there. All right, and so that when it's spinning, it's going to have the same amount of weight on both sides of the inside of that centrifuge, and it's going to promote an even spinning. All right, so once the tubes are in the centrifuge appropriately, press the lid down until it clicks, move over the locking mechanism on the lid, And then you're simply going to turn the centrifuge on if you haven't already, and hit the button if there is a button to start the spin. So this particular centrifuge does not have a button to spin. You just turn the timer to whatever you want it to be set at, and that's going to initiate the spinning process. So you're going to see a very slow increase in the RPMs of the device because it's going to want to, it doesn't want to start super, super quickly. It's going to sort of ramp up, and that's going to prevent too much jostling of the blood inside the tubes, which is something you don't want. You don't want the tubes being sort of jostled around because it's going to increase the likelihood of damaging the sample. All right, so once the centrifuge is done, it's going to start to break itself. If you have the brake applied, you can see that the RPMs are going to slow down fairly quickly. If you don't have the brake applied, it takes a very long time for the centrifuge to stop. All right, so once the centrifuge has stopped, you can open it. So you're simply going to flip the switch back on the locking mechanism on the lid, and then there's a button on the front of the centrifuge that you have to push to actually open the lid. So there's two different locks here. So once both those locks are undone, you can lift the lid, take the samples out, and you can use them however you plan on using them. So when you're taking the tubes out of the centrifuge and to wherever your workstation is, or when you're working with them at the workstation, make sure that you never invert those tubes again. So if you invert the tubes, you're going to see that the blood remixes partially, and essentially you're ruining your sample by doing that. So if you look at your tubes after they've been centrifuged, there's going to be a clear separation between the blood cells at the bottom and the clearer liquid on top. So what that clear liquid is, it depends on the type of tube, whether it was a coagulant or an anticoagulant tube. So again, the anticoagulant tubes are going to have plasma in them, so that liquid's going to still contain platelets. The coagulating tubes are going to have serum in them because all the platelets have coagulated and been spun to the closer to the cells in the bottom, the red blood cells at the bottom. All right, so either way, you're going to take those tubes, you're going to very gently remove the top, so just kind of wiggle it back and forth until it's able to pop off, and then you're going to take some sort of pipette. So we're just going to be using a simple bulb transfer pipette today, and you're going to suck up that serum or plasma and transfer it into some sort of container to be used in a machine or to be stored in a freezer. All right, so when you're sucking up that serum or plasma, though, start at the very top. So start at the top of the plasma and slowly work your way down as the plasma is sucked up into the bulb pipette. So the reason you're doing that is if you get too close to the cells about midway down the tube, you're going to disturb those cells. In doing so, it's going to remix the tube of blood, and it's going to essentially destroy your sample. So start at the top very conservatively, suck a little bit of the serum or plasma, and continue to lower the pipette as you're sucking up serum or plasma, and stop when either you fill the pipette or if you get too close to the cells where you start thinking that maybe you might suck a little bit of the cells up and mix your sample. So stop before that happens. Then take that sample, put it wherever you're going to store or use it, and then if you need more, you can go back and try to get a little bit more serum or plasma, but you want to make sure that you get the easy serum and plasma first before you start getting a little more gutsy and getting the serum or plasma that's closer to the cells. So once you have transfer all of your serum or plasma to another container that you're going to use for analysis or for storage, you have officially aliquoted the serum and plasma. So if you're going to store it, make sure that it goes into a refrigerator or freezer more likely, and that happens quickly, because any time that the sample is at room temperature, it is degrading the sample. So make sure that you get it into its storage location as quickly as you can. All right, so that was a really quick overview on how to spin blood and pull off either the serum or plasma for storage or use. If you have any questions, please put those in the comments below and I'll try to get back to you. Otherwise, please come back and watch another video. Thanks.